reduced the HIV transmission from the control group from 4.5% incidence to 2.2%, there is an excitement in public health. And everybody says, oh, this is, treating STI syndrome is not expensive compared to having somebody with HIV and then you are going through this whole plethora of a complex socio-medical disease. So the public health will then say that, okay, even to identify sexually transmitted infections in individual is so complex, people may come or may not come. So wherever we are finding pockets of high transmission, let's go and treat people with mass treatment. So give them a pack and make sure that while you're watching, they take your medicines. Now, that kind of thing was done in Rakai. And they did this mass treatment for a population of 8,000 people in these few villages around. And it did not show any major impact when you are doing a mass STI treatment. There could be several reasons for it, and I know the question you asked was a fundamental public health inquiry, that what is so different between Mwanza and Rakai? Is the population different? Are the occurrence of STIs different in those in Rakai district? And I think I like the question. It's a very sound mind who has asked this question. And but the question here in public health also is that we do inquiry into the possible biases that might be in these two comparable two studies and how to interpret. Having done all that, yes, the quality of genital ulcers in Rakai were more herpetic and less amenable to mass treatment. There were a lot of these things came up and suggested that you cannot globally prescribe mass treatment because every population that you want to improve their genital health using the STI syndromic management will have to first describe what kind of STIs they have rather than just say that, okay, now globally, wherever there is HIV, go to that village or go to that city and town and prescribe one single mass treatment. That's one. By the way, it reminds me that for the younger group, younger generation to know that Rakai in Uganda is considered to be the ground zero. You know, we are talking about ground zero of swine flu now. Yeah, the ground zero of swine flu in Mexico, in Guadalajara, and you have that one place where there's a pig farm and there's a small little kid they were showing you on the BBC yesterday, 6 or 7 years old kid who was the case zero on a ground zero. Now this Rakai is the ground zero of AIDS. Ground zero would be what I was telling you, the story of the African green monkey. But Rakai is the ground zero where the story that was then medically investigated was that there was this person who used to come cross over from Tanzania into Rakai district of, that's a bordering between the two countries, and there was this person who used to sell chitenge. Chitenge is the, what you know, the long piece of cloth which is more like a batik, African batik, and the African women will wear across like a skirt. I don't know what you call it here, anything that you would put across your skirt, yeah, okay. So it's a cloth that is like a, used to be used as a skirt. And so this cloth seller would pass over, walk over from Tanzania, bring the batik, and then women who would like and like to buy this and didn't have money would pay in terms of sex. And finally it turned out to be that when this person came down with with the AIDS, and started to come to this Rakai village less frequently because of illnesses, then all the women who had sex with him for exchange for favors started also getting sick. So this was then considered that this whole village had a very high prevalence of HIV, and a lot of women were actually infected more women than men. So that is known as ground zero of AIDS in the world. Very, very high level of infection in Rakai, to an extent that this person, I forget his name now, but this person who was a cloth seller caused an entire population shift in that area, so that what was left behind were all the young children and grandparents, because directly or indirectly there were all phantom sexual partners, the real sexual partners, the direct partners, the indirect partners. You know, the sexual trees, I would suggest to the public health specialists and the students that you try to draw a sexual tree of an individual, including yourself, and see how complex it gets.
Okay, maybe that's the homework for the students. Okay, and about VCT centers, yeah. Who are the counselor?
There is another one is who are the VCT counselors? They generally are public health nurses in Africa and Latin America. Countries which are not able to mobilize a large cadre of clinical psychologists have mobilized the public health nurses and also the community people who are good at counseling techniques. So there are different responses in terms of who are the VCT counselors. It is depends on the availability of manpower in that particular area. The ideal situation is, and which India has been able to mobilize in large number, is the clinical psychologists coming out of the university studies, and they are good at being professional counselors in VCTs. But if you don't have, then like what Africa and Latin America has done, is public health nurses and also the community counselors. And one, of course, the major group is the people living with HIV and AIDS. They are very, very good counselors. So once they are given techniques and training, they can be very, very good counselors. So they should also be considered. There was a question about female having sex with female contact and why it is not considered as high-risk group. It is a high-risk behavior, no doubt. I mean, basically any sexual activity that is penetrative is high risk. Since the female-female sexual contact is not penetrative, unless it is made penetrative, that's the reason it is considered as low risk, but it is risk. And in case of female-female transmission, it is generally the sharing of the sexual toys, because the female sexual contact normally involves the use of vibrators and other sexual toys which are injurious. They can cause injuries to genitals, and then also the secretions from one woman to go into the genitals of the other woman, and also the orogenital sex that happens can cause the reason of risk. But it is low risk because there is generally no organ penetration in female-female contact. I think there's one question about how to reduce HIV transmission in emergency. And there are phases in emergency that have to look at health and disease, including the infectious diseases like sexual diseases and HIV. What is primary is that there is an acute phase after an emergency, which is generally considered to be 8 to 15 days, depending on the type of emergency. And that is a time when you are trying to mobilize and stabilize the population that has been displaced, and they are provided food and shelter and security from whatever other factors around. And during that time, you have a master plan that will come up. You don't have to look at giving them condoms in the first 15 days of acute phase of an emergency, because that is not what is on the mind of people when they are in a situation of displacement. And this, so normally it comes into the second phase and the third phase, where you bring stability to the populations in terms of having enough employment so that they are not vulnerable from lack of money or lack of food or lack of shelter, and then of course provide all the interventions that we have discussed in terms of including the condom. Great.
Okay, you missed one question about why you differentiate between transgender and MSM, although they have the same sexual patterns, yeah?
Yes, I think it's traditionally done because there are risk behavior characteristics that are not absolutely similar, but they are more or less penetratively similar. But there are also behavioral characteristics that are a bit different. And you know, the scientific community is driven by the identity that the group wants to keep. So we are driven by science, but at the same time the transgenders would want to be identified as a separate group, although their organ penetration process is the same like MSM. So we in public health or in the health sciences, we respect the group identity that the transgenders want to keep. Yeah.
Okay, so this is the end of our discussion session, and then let's give us applause to Professor Hira. Okay, today we miss University of Erlangga because they cannot follow this session because they have another event in their site. But next week they will join us. Okay, and then we will invite another session. So Professor Suwarta Kusens is already here. So let's have a break for 5 minutes. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Shall we proceed to the second session of this day, of today? Before we continue with the session, may I ask you and remind you to mute all of your microphones so that it will not interfere the communication between this station and your sites. Okay, this session we will have very distinguished person in Indonesia relating with HIV and also relating with the health economics in Indonesia. Here on my right, we have Mr. Suwarta Kosen. He was graduated from medical school at the University of Indonesia and got his master from the University of the Philippines and his doctor from the Johns Hopkins University. Dr. Suwarta Kosen has involved in so many research, and he is now working at the National Institute of Health Research and Development of the Ministry of Health, Republic of Indonesia, as the chairperson of the Scientific Research Commission. Dr. Suwarta Kosen will discuss or will deliver some information about the economic effect of HIV and AIDS for the case of Africa and some countries, and how we can mitigate the economic impact of the HIV and AIDS. Okay, let's start the lecture. Dr. Suwarta Kosen, it's your time.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, everybody. So I will present about the mitigation of the economic impact of HIV AIDS by using the case of Africa region and countries. We know that despite increased global commitment to control HIV AIDS pandemic in the last decade, the virus continues to transmit at alarming speed. At present, it is estimated that about 65 million people have contracted the virus globally, and over 22 million people have died from HIV-related illness. In sub-Saharan Africa and in countries such as Botswana, Swaziland, Zimbabwe, the epidemic produces illness, death, poverty, and misery in a large scale. In that region also, 57% of those infected are female, women, and girls. With only 10% of the world population in Africa, but it accounts for 66% of all HIV infection worldwide, and more than 75% of AIDS-related deaths. Besides killing people, actually, the disease also imposes heavy burden on families and communities, and also on agricultural sustainability, business, health sector, education, and national economic growth. The disease basically diminishes the capacity of African countries to maintain the previous achievement, like in child survival, in social and economic development. Across the African continent, HIV/AIDS manifests itself as an immediate crisis and also as a systemic condition. A crisis because of the high speed of transmission. Infection rates have increased from 4 to 20% or more among adult population in a decade. Systemic condition, since it impacts heavily on the prime age adults, in the productive age of the adults. With HIV seropositive level reaching 35% or more in some countries like Botswana, Zimbabwe, Swaziland, the condition urges the national government actually to focus not only on the crisis condition, but also to focus on the systemic characteristic of the epidemic. The disease is already having a devastating impact on the communities. This devastating impact demographically has resulted in loss of life and also loss of population. The UN in 2002, after incorporating the effects of HIV/AIDS for the 53 hardest hit countries, these are the countries where 90% of the adults living with HIV, estimated that the annual number of deaths reached 1 million in the early 1990s and over 4 million by 2003, and this keep increasing. About 100 million additional deaths are expected in 38 most affected African countries by 2025 as a result of the epidemic. This means those countries will have 14% fewer inhabitants than without HIV epidemic. And remember, this is only one disease, and in Africa there are so many other diseases also. Outside Africa, the demographic effects are relatively moderate. Prior to 2025, AIDS is expected to cause 31 million additional deaths in India. India, a country with 1.2 billion population, and about 18 million in China. This is the country also with about 1.6 billion population. By 2020 or to 2025, basically nearly 10 years of life expectancy will be lost in those 38 countries. This is a sad condition, because to achieve a better life expectancy, actually so many efforts have been conducted. Significant reduction of life expectancy will also be experienced by developing countries outside Africa, such as Bahama, Cambodia, Dominica, Haiti, and also Myanmar. Botswana, at present, has the highest HIV prevalence rate in the world. The current life expectancy is around 40 years as a result of deaths related to AIDS. Actually, it achieved 65 years between 1990 to 1995. Similar conditions also experienced by countries like Zimbabwe, Angola, Lesotho, Malawi, Mozambique, Rwanda, and Zambia. A severe deficit of working age people will be experienced by 2025. Their population pyramid also have a new shape. We call it population chimney. So if we see this, the demographic pyramid, we see the black one basically showing the current, and the white one deficit due to HIV/AIDS. So the form will like the chimney actually. Many studies basically predict that the disease will substantially reduce economic growth, and this comes the socioeconomic impact of the disease. It will hit in several fronts at once, and resulting in like reduced saving and investment of the people and of the country, loss of experienced labor, and lowered productivity. So many skilled labor either they cannot work because of debilitating disease or died. Excessive absenteeism, so many, even the civil servants cannot do or are not in their work, so they need to recruit new people. High health care and death benefits costs. This is also a burden for the country and also for the private insurance company. Reduced return on investment in health and education, because they already spend so much for health education and now everything is gone because of the disease. And decline of the worker morale. So HIV/AIDS basically a serious threat to the economic productivity and profitability of countries with high infection rates. The most damaging impact are the younger and productive population. The loss of trained and skilled workers in their prime has severe implications for development and business. This reduces economic growth basically and alter the economic structure. So basically if we transform this one to money, this become billion and billion of dollars. So stigma, prejudice, ignorance, and discrimination cause difficulties in raising awareness of the community and people. The disease also has changed from the health issue to a development crisis. So there are problem with personnel, with skilled personnel, problem with economy, and ability of countries to improve economic conditions, social well-being is threatened basically. The scale of infection in many African countries has economic implication at household level, national budget, and also for businesses. So sustainable development is feasible if countries can tame the diseases that disempower people to prevent the damaging of social fabric, diminishing agricultural and industrial production, undermine political, social, and economic stability, and contribute also to regional and global insecurity. So we can see now, like in Sub-Saharan Africa, there are some problems not only because of this disease, but also insecurity of the country. Increased cost of medical care also become a problem for household. Decreased ability of a family to earn income because of sickness and or undertake productive and domestic work also influence the household prosperity. In Zimbabwe, UNAIDS in the year 2000 stated that the production in agriculture of household in AIDS that decreased significantly, like for maize, decrease of the output reduction by 67%, cotton 47%, vegetable also 50%, groundnuts 37%, and cattle owned by 39%. This is because they spend also for the healthcare, the cost of healthcare. Increased AIDS related poverty. So basically, many households fall into poverty because they have to spend money for medical care, and also there is no earning, basically. Rising numbers of orphan children also become a problem because so many in number. And basically, taking in orphan children will add burden to the already poor household. Destroy human capital selectively because people with accumulated experiences, job skill, and knowledge basically disappear or gone. There is a threat also of worsening inequality. So basically, the poor become poorer. And this become